Have another frame of reference. So hope you enjoy that point of view. Let us know where you're at and how we can pray for you this morning. A few announcements before we begin our service today. Yesterday we had a beautiful memorial service for Stephanie Hall Mullen. We had her family and friends and co-workers, and we celebrated her life. And the family left some lovely flowers here. As you go out after church, there's this beautiful spray of flowers. Take one or two home. It was just such a lovely arrangement. I didn't want to take it all apart and try to put it up here. I thought, let's take this arrangement, take one or two flowers home, and that's your way of remembering Stephanie. So as you leave the sanctuary, as you leave in the narthex, you'll see the flowers. So help yourself as you go out. A few other announcements. Immediately after the service, elders, let's just gather briefly. We'll just have a quick check-in and make sure we have all our schedules for the holidays. So we'll just meet briefly in the parlor right after the service. And another announcement, on Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, the 21st, at 5 p.m., we will have this, for the first time, I think, at Northwest, a service. It's called the Longest Night Service. And as you know, that's the longest night of the year. And in many churches, this day, this evening, is celebrated in a way as a kind of a quiet, meditative, prayerful service to say goodbye to the year, to put away burdens and grief and all the heavy stuff that might have happened this year, and just kind of let it go and turn to the light, turn to God's light as we enter the Christmas season and beyond. So you're invited to come to that. We do need to know you're coming because we are planning some activities and, of course, a soup supper. So we have to make sure we have enough for everybody. So there is a sign-up sheet. Again, as you enter and leave the narthex, you will see a sheet. Just put down how many people are coming, and we will welcome you that evening. This has been Jennifer Jacobson's kind of her idea, her baby. So I'm thrilled to be your colleague and peer in this particular endeavor. So welcome. We hope that you can join us that evening. There are other announcements in the bulletin. Take a moment to look through those. Prayer concerns are there. Please lift up these persons in prayer and let us know if there are other prayer concerns that I should note. Always let me know by either filling out a prayer concern card or calling the office or texting me, emailing, however works for you. Just make sure that we know so we can keep each other in prayer. The Happy Mitten Tree is filled up. Have you seen that? It looks lovely. It's about to topple over, but there is still room for more if you would still like to donate some warm hats, mittens, gloves, scarves. We donate these to people that need some warm clothes because it's cold outside. And Christmas services. Please note, Christmas Eve, 5 p.m. This is a traditional Lessons and Carols service. And then on Sunday morning, Christmas Day, we'll have a brief service at 10 o'clock. So hopefully you can join us for one of those. Well, friends, that's all I have. Take a moment. Reach out to your neighbor and say, Merry Holidays. Friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship the Lord.
Next day, the days start getting longer.
Yes.
Sunday of Advent. On this day we light the fourth candle, the candle of love.
We rejoice because God's steadfast love has been made known to us through Jesus Christ.
Divine love, which heals and transforms lives, has come down to us this Advent season. With great joy, we receive that love and share it with others.
We light these candles representing hope, peace, joy, and love, as a sign that no matter our circumstance, we know we are not alone. Emmanuel, God, is with us. May the light of love shine through us and brighten our world.
That we may truly receive this wondrous gift. Open our ears to hear the voices of those who cry out in their need, and help us to respond in caring ways. Forgive our failings, and help us to try again and again to be the kind of faith-filled people you would have us be. O God of wisdom, as the nights have grown longer, so has darkness grown and wrapped itself around our hearts. Help us to be mindful of all those persons for whom the holidays are not filled with joy. And in this season of light, we ask your healing blessings upon all that we carry in our hearts. We pray for the lonely, that they might find comfort. We pray for the downtrodden and the marginalized, that they might find relief from their burdens. We pray for those wrestling with depression, that a light of calm might bring them peace. We pray for those dealing with stress, that they might find the courage to let go. We pray for the grief-stricken, that they might experience the newness of life that you bring. Hear now the prayers of our hearts in the silence of this moment. Eternal God, keep us mindful of the ways in which we can be of help to our neighbors in need. And remind us always that joy and peace is what we all seek and what we can offer the world through Jesus. For it is in his name we pray this prayer and the prayer he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, we're having a children's moment today, so Levi and Ruth. And I believe Linus and Cambria today. To play his drum for his family and for the people who lived nearby. Everyone called him the little drummer boy. Now this little drummer boy and his mother and father were very, very poor, but when they heard the news that baby Jesus, the newborn king, was born, they wanted to go with all the other people to see him and give him what gift they could. The little boy's mother would take a loaf of bread she had baked. His father would take an extra woolen blanket to help keep the baby Jesus warm. But the little drummer boy didn't think he had any gift. The little drummer boy didn't even think he had anything to give Levi. Until, all of a sudden, he remembered. He thought he could play his drum for the newborn king. Since all the townspeople loved to hear him play his drum, he just knew that baby Jesus would love it too. And so the little drummer boy went to see the newborn king and played his drum for him. And you know what? Baby Jesus smiled. So the little drummer boy came up with a good gift. What kind of a gift would you like if you were going to Jesus' birthday party? What kind of a gift do you think you'd like to take? What's a really good gift? Okay, well, you know, that's okay. I was thinking, though, that sometimes, you know, the best gift to give somebody isn't anything material. It's the gift of love. You can just love people, and that's the best gift. In fact, There's a Bible verse that even says so. In 1 Corinthians, it says, there are three things that remain, faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. So that's okay. Okay, we're going to sing on behalf of the drummer boy. We're going to sing his little song. I can find the music. Okay. And now it's time for the drum. And Mike's going to drum with you, so you can just do what he does. Okay, here we go.
Yeah.
In keeping with the theme of children's messages today, and I agree with you, Pat, maybe you don't need this sermon. Maybe we should just do the drummer boy again, right? But in keeping with that theme, there's a story about a pastor who served a church many years ago. And he told this story about his congregation's Christmas traditions, which included a children's pageant. And one Sunday, weeks before that big day, their youngest son came home from Sunday school with the announcement that he had a big part in the nativity play. And this little boy was so proud. He was finally old enough to play a real person and not a lamb or sheep or donkey or whatever else. It's really cute, but doesn't have speaking part. But you see, there was a small problem. This little boy couldn't remember what part he had. He tried to remember, and all he could think of was the letter B. It started with the letter B. And his family just, scratched their heads. They looked through the Bible. They said, we don't know who that is. So they tried to figure it out, and they finally had to admit they were stumped. They don't know what B stood for. So they arrived at the Sunday school the following week for the first of many rehearsals, and they discovered that B stood for bystander. The little boy had no speaking part, and his only role was to just stand there and look cute and smile and move when told. As I reflect on that little story, I have to wonder if the word bystander meant he played Joseph. You see, Joseph is an interesting figure. But let's talk about the four Gospels for a moment and this one story of the Nativity, the story of Jesus, told from different points of view. The birth narrative, which is part of the larger story, right, is told differently in each Gospel. And with each gospel, you have a different focus. For example, Mark's gospel doesn't include a birth story at all, right? It jumps right into the action with the baptism of Jesus and the beginning of his ministry. And John's birth story, well, it's a bit mystical. It connects the creation story in Genesis with Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That's John's birth story. It signals that Jesus is the beginning for new life. Luke shares the story of the angels singing and the shepherds running to see the baby Jesus. And Luke focuses on Mary. Luke highlights her role by giving her this beautiful song, these beautiful words in the early chapters. And Joseph is that quiet bystander in Luke's gospel. The action is focused on Mary. But Matthew's gospel, which you just heard read, the gospel writer makes Joseph a central figure. Joseph is no mere bystander. Although he is silent, he is the main character who makes some crucial decisions. Now, last week I spoke about Mary and her role in the larger story of God's love for humanity. And today let's look at Joseph. The gospel tells us that Joseph is not the biological father, but Joseph claimed the child and raised Jesus along with Mary. And his role was important in Jesus' development. So what role does Joseph play in this story, and what can we learn from him? Here are a few thoughts. First of all, an important lesson is that we learn from Joseph to do the right thing. Do the right thing, but not at the cost of showing compassion for others. In other words, do the right thing, but do it with love. Matthew's gospel describes Joseph as a righteous man. Righteousness is this great biblical concept, but I fear that it's misunderstood. In our context, sometimes when we say someone is righteous, it means they're pious or holier than thou, a do-gooder. And very often, if you call someone a righteous so-and-so, well, that's not necessarily a good thing. But in the biblical context, righteousness means observing the religious laws and faithfully upholding covenants. So being a righteous man meant that Joseph followed the teachings of the religious law according to the Torah. And according to Jewish law, Joseph could have publicly shamed Mary. He could have publicly shamed her for her unexpected pregnancy. And if Joseph strictly adhered to the law, he could have publicly humiliated Mary to restore his own status in the community. He could have left her and the baby without any repercussions to himself. But Joseph's righteousness was not lacking compassion. He could not leave Mary or the baby to suffer such public shame. And as important as following the law and keeping the covenant were to Joseph, he was flexible. And he chose to do that right thing with love and compassion. So the lesson for us is we too can choose to be obedient. We too can choose to commit ourselves to keep our covenants and our rules and our laws. We too can strive for righteousness. But like Joseph, we must always act with compassion and love. What good does it do if we follow the rules but show no love? And that was Jesus' message as well. And I wonder if Jesus learned that lesson from Joseph. So we can learn from Joseph and do the right thing with love and compassion. That's our first lesson. Another interesting lesson we learn from this scripture is the importance of dreams. Now, I have to admit, when someone says, God came to me in a dream, I will most likely inwardly roll my eyes. I admit I'm a bit skeptical about this, but let's look at this biblical concept of dreams through our 21st century eyes. See what we can learn from Joseph. Dr. Lee Butler Jr., the academic dean at Phillips Theological Seminary in Tulsa, writes about Joseph in his contribution to the seminary's Advent devotional. And Dr. Butler, a scholar of African American studies, writes about the importance of dreams in his culture. Dreams are, he writes, understood to be messages from God as a guidance for daily living. In his experience, paying attention to your dreams is a way to promote individual and communal well-being. And in his context, dreaming, like praying, is a way to talk with God. And it's not unusual to hear people speak of their dreams. Think of Joseph's dream as a conversation with God. And this conversation directly affected his well-being, Joseph's well-being, but as well as the well-being of Mary, the person he was to marry, and of course the child that she carried. And I wonder how often we have dreams that seem to reveal something important but are forgotten or discarded as soon as we wake up. Has that happened to you? I know many times I get ideas for sermons or Bible studies in my dreams, and then I wake up and I'm like, oh, that was a good one. What was it? Why is that? Is it possible that our subconscious guides us? Is it possible that God's Spirit talks to us in dreams? Maybe I shouldn't be so skeptical after all and keep my eye rolls quiet. According to Dr. Butler, when Joseph woke up and followed his dream, he became an active agent within God's plan for redeeming creation. These words reminded me of another famous dream. On August 28, 1963, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. stood on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C., and using his own cultural context, his African-American context, he spoke these words. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, The sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at a table of brotherhood. His dream was a call to action to promote the well-being of many who suffered for too long. So maybe we can think of dreams as God's prompt to action. So we learn from Joseph that God is always participating in our lives and nudging us a bit, sometimes in dreams. God is nudging us to participate in the well-being of the people around us, as well as our own well-being. So how is God speaking to you? Friends, if we learn anything from Joseph, is to dream. Dream big for yourself and others and imagine the possibilities. And one more lesson from Joseph. Joseph's role was important for all of these things that I have mentioned, but his final act in this birth story was of the utmost importance. Joseph had a job to do, as was the tradition in Jewish families. Joseph named the child, and he named the baby Jesus from the Hebrew Yeshua, meaning God saves. And that is the name that appears throughout the rest of the gospel. But there is another name as told in Isaiah's prophecy, Emmanuel, which means God with us. And by naming this child, Joseph gives voice to the birth story's reality and heart. God is with us. This is the incarnation. What does it mean to say that God is with us? Well, there's that element of comfort. We are not alone in our joys. We are not alone in our suffering. There is comfort. But there's also responsibility when we say God is with us. There's also the element that if God is with us and we are God's people, and as God's people, we are a sign of God in the world. In other words, we act as God's agents in the world. So if we say God with us, what we do, what we say matters. If we say God with us, how we present ourselves to the world is important. If we say God with us, if we don't act with love and compassion, others will look at us and say, well, if that's what it means to have God with you, I want nothing to do with that. And I'm afraid that that happens too often. To say God with us, is that a heavy burden? There's no pressure, right, to say God with us. Well, friends, we don't have to get everything right. We don't. We're human. That's not what it means to be God's people. But back to my first point, we must act with love and compassion as we show the world that God is with us. And as we show the world that we follow that baby named Emmanuel. And no one said following Jesus would be easy. Jesus certainly didn't say that. He would be the first one to say, carry your cross. But ultimately, Joseph, that man of few words, that bystander, he has so much to teach us. Joseph's story shows us what Emmanuel, God with us, means. Emmanuel, God with us, means if we call ourselves people of faith, we call ourselves followers of Jesus, God's people, then we are living examples of what Emmanuel, God with us, means. Emmanuel, God with us, means doing the right thing with love and never at the expense of another. Emmanuel, God with us, means that when we are faced with difficult situations or when something unexpected demands our attention, we try to do the right thing, but do it with love and compassion. Err on the side of love. Emmanuel, God with us, means we listen to that quiet inner voice, dreams, if you will. for God's call on our lives as we act with justice for those around us. Emmanuel, God with us, means naming the realities that God often calls us to do something unexpected and different. We learn all that from Joseph. And last week we met Mary. Remember her beautiful, joyous song as she said yes to God? Today we met Joseph, quietly taking part in that greater story of God's love for humanity. So my prayer is that their story continues to inspire us. And may their story inspire us not to just be bystanders in our own lives, but to take an active role, to take an active part in God's call to share Emmanuel, God with us, with the world. Amen.
We reach the point in the service in which we are reminded in this season of giving of our calling to share our gifts with this congregation, of our chance and our opportunity, our invitation in Emmanuel, God with us, to share in the giving of love in tangible ways. And so as the body of Christ in this congregation, we gratefully receive offerings. And we, just on a logistical note, receive those offerings here in person, online, or by mail. We give thanks for all of you this season, knowing that your gifts help with the ministry of this church. I invite you to pray with me. We celebrate your love, God of life, in these gifts and in the daily lives we lead that allow us to share our offerings. We ask you, God, to bless our tokens of our very selves so that the world may receive your ultimate gift of love of God with us in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Emmanuel, God with us, as we gather at this table, we thank you for the gift of your birth and presence among us. As we commune here today, we rejoice in our communion with all the saints knit together in the body of Christ. As we eat of your bread and drink of this cup, we pray to be sent forth in your love. We pray to remember always the gift of your presence here among us as we go to serve all of your people, strengthened by the gift of your salvation, by the gift of your body and blood, this bread and this wine given for us this day. Amen.
We remember that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread, and as he sat around the table, he blessed it and broke it and shared with his disciples and said, "Take and eat, all of you. This is my body given for you." And likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and after he had blessed it, he shared with his disciples and he said, "Drink of this, all of you. For this is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And so together, as the body of Christ, we share the bread of heaven and the cup of salvation.
Thank you.
join me in the closing prayer. Loving God, thank you for this holy meal, for the way it feeds our souls, changes our hearts, and unites us with you. Be born in us anew each day, so that we may live as followers of Christ, who seek to love, serve, and heal the world. In his name we pray. Amen. We stand as you are able for the final hymn, O Little Town of Bethlehem. Unto you. The Lord lift you up and grant you peace now and forevermore. Go in peace.